Hello, space fans, and welcome to a somewhat nasally edition of Space Fan News. Sorry, I'm getting over a cold. First up, this week, astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope have figured out what causes short-duration gamma-ray bursts. For a long time, they believed that gamma-ray bursts were created when two small, super-dense stellar objects, like a pair of neutron stars or a neutron star in a black hole, merge. For this to be true, though, the theories predicted there should be a stellar blast about 1,000 times brighter than a regular nova that accompanies the GRB. Called a kilonova, you know, 1,000 times brighter than a nova, they haven't been observed until now. Now, for those who don't know, gamma-ray bursts are mysterious flashes of intense, high-energy radiation that appear from random directions in space. Short-duration blasts last at most a few seconds, but they sometimes generate faint afterglows in visible and near-infrared light that continue for several hours or days. And these afterglows have helped astronomers determine that GRBs lie in distant galaxies. The cause of short-duration GRBs, however, remains a mystery. Until, like I just said, now. Using Hubble observations of our old friend GRB 130603b, which is the same event that I reported on in SFM 104, remember? That was the one where they said gold was created. GRB 130630b is about 4 billion light years away, and it lasted about 2/10 of a second. Well, inside the very same GRB, astronomers observed their very first kilonova, which provides the strongest evidence yet, which supports the idea of merging of small, dense stellar objects to create GRBs. That was a pretty productive 2/10 of a second. First, we learned where all the gold in the universe came from, and then we learned what causes GRBs in the first place. Not bad. So here's how it all goes down. The event happens as the system starts emitting gravitational radiation, tiny ripples in the fabric of space-time. The energy dissipated by the waves causes the two objects to sweep closer and closer together. In the final milliseconds, as the two objects merge, the death spiral kicks out highly radioactive material. This material heats up and expands, emitting a burst of light. This powerful kilonova blast emits as much visible and near-infrared light every second as the sun does every few years. A kilonova can last for about a week. So now we have novae, which are just your regular old stellar explosions. Then we have kilonovae, which are 1,000 times brighter, and supernovae, which are 100 times brighter than that. Novae are caused by accreting gases onto a white dwarf star, causing a sudden brightening. Kilonovae, we've learned today, are caused by merging neutron stars or neutron stars and black holes. And supernovae are caused by the deaths of very massive stars. So there's your roundup of stellar blasts. Next, astronomers using infrared data from the Subaru telescope in Hawaii have imaged a giant planet around the bright star GJ504. This giant planet is about 4 times the mass of Jupiter, and the observation marks the lowest mass exoplanet we've seen yet around a sun-like star. According to astronomers, if we could travel to this giant planet, we would see a world still glowing from the heat of its formation, with a color reminiscent of a dark cherry blossom, which is kind of a dull magenta. The near-infrared camera reveals that its color is much more blue than other imaged planets, which may indicate that its atmosphere has fewer clouds. GJ504b orbits its star at roughly 9 times the distance Jupiter orbits the Sun, which represents a bit of a problem to theoretical ideas of how giant planets form. According to the most widely accepted picture, called the core accretion model, Jupiter-like planets get their start in the gas-rich debris disk that surrounds a young star. A core produced by collisions among asteroids and comets provides a seed, and when this core reaches sufficient mass, its gravitational pull starts rapidly attracting gas from the disk to form the planet. While this model works fine for planets out to where Neptune orbits, which is about 30 times the distance the Earth is from the Sun, which is about 30 AU, it's more problematic for worlds located farther from their stars. GJ504b lies at a projected distance of 43.5 astronomical units from its star. The actual distance depends on how the system tips to our line of sight, which is not precisely known. So the existence of this planet where it is hard to explain, and we may need to reassess some of the basic assumptions of the core accretion theory. Now, another thing that's cool about this observation was the way it was done. In the past, you've heard me talk about radial velocity method, transit method, and microlensing techniques for observing exoplanets. Well, this planet was observed directly as part of a project called SEEDS, which stands for Strategic Exploration of Exoplanets and Disks with Subaru. SEEDS is a project designed to directly image extrasolar planets and protoplanetary disks around several hundred nearby stars using the Subaru telescope on Mauna Kea, Hawaii. The 5-year project began in 2009. While direct imaging is arguably the most important technique for observing planets around other stars, it's also the most challenging. But it's worth doing because you can learn so much more by looking directly at a planet in the near IR. Imaging provides information about the planet's luminosity, temperature, atmosphere, and orbit, but it's hard because planets are so faint and so close to their host stars, it's like trying to take a picture of a firefly near a searchlight. The researchers find that GJ504b is about 4 times more massive than Jupiter and has an effective temperature of about 460 degrees Fahrenheit or 237 degrees Celsius. Finally, astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope yet again have solved a 40-year mystery on the origin of the Magellanic Stream, which is a long ribbon of gas stretching nearly halfway around our Milky Way galaxy. Since the stream's discovery by radio telescopes in the early 1970s, astronomers have wondered whether the gas comes from one or both of the satellite galaxies. Now, new Hubble observations reveal that most of the gas was stripped from the small Magellanic Cloud about 2 billion years ago, and a second region of the stream originated more recently from the Large Magellanic Cloud. The team found a low amount of oxygen and sulfur along most of the stream, and this matched the levels in the Small Magellanic Cloud about 2 billion years ago, when the gaseous ribbon was thought to have formed. Now, one day, the Magellanic Stream may rain down onto the Milky Way's disk, fueling the birth of new stars. This infusion of fresh gas is part of one process that triggers star formation in a galaxy. Astronomers want to know the origin of that wayward gas in order to more fully understand how galaxies make new stars. And now they do. Just like downtown. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thank you for watching. And as always, keep looking up. I want to thank Scott Lewis for hosting last week's Space Fan News, and I also want to thank you guys for welcoming him so kindly. I really appreciate it. Scott will be back next week because now we're going to start doing some tag teaming on this a little bit because he's helping me out because I want to get to other video projects in the future, which you will see on this channel as they become available, and I hope you enjoy them. So thank you guys all for everything you're doing, and thank you for being so great. Because According to the most widely accepted picture, as part of a project called SEED, which stands for Strategic Exploration of Since the stream's discovery, well, that's interesting. Now, the way they did this was light from distant quasars went through the stream and lit up the stream a little bit, and they detected these elements from the way the elements were absorbed in ultraviolet light. I'm going to cut that whole thing out because it didn't make any sense.